Hey church, welcome back to our Summer of Love series. If you're a visitor here with us today, we love having you with us. If you've stumbled across this video on YouTube, it's great to have you. Let me tell you a little bit about who we are as a church. We worship Jesus, we follow the teachings of Jesus, we love and we serve Jesus' people, and we want to tell others about Jesus. That's who we are and that's what we do. You might be wondering, why would you record the videos of the sermons for our series, Summer of Love, through the January month? Well, a couple of reasons, and it's all around being prepared. First, we're somewhat expecting that lockdown may well occur during this month or some of the early months of this year. And so we're just wanting to be prepared and have a few sermons in the bank. Secondly, to prepare you guys for the reality that hybrid churches where we meet in person in homes and watch videos at different stages, is likely to be the norm for a while. And so we just want to be in that rhythm so that we're used to it, so that we're not confronted by it, it's not weird. And so can I just encourage you, lean into these sermons. Don't be distracted, oh, it's just a video on the screen. No, lean in, get what God wants for you through this series. And third, it gives us an opportunity as pastors to be prepared for the messages we're going to preach through the year. It gives me a little bit more study time and preparation to pray into what God has for us as we open His Word this year. And I'm actually really excited to share with you a little of what God is wanting to teach us this year through His Word coming up. So be looking forward to that. Hey, so we're talking about the Summer of Love. You know, our world is really confused when it comes to love. We say that we love our pizza and our partner. And while those two things may be true, it's possibly going to leave our partner feeling a little underloved, you know? And so there is this sense, and maybe you've heard it before, that the Greek language has four main words that they use to talk about love, and that's just part of the story. The word is very clear on what God's love means and what it looks like. And so we're wanting to bring this clarity to a confused world from this clear message of what love is that comes from the Word. And so let me just remind you a little bit that it's coming through a real boiling pot, mixing pot of cultures in the New Testament. So these New Testament authors, they're ethnically Jewish. That means their religious language, the language that they spoke and thought in at church services, was Hebrew. But the language that they would talk about these Old Testament stories in would have been Aramaic. They would have been around the campfire. They would have been in the kitchen at home chatting in Aramaic about Hebrew stories. And that Aramaic language comes from their Babylonian exile time. But not just that. When they went to the marketplace, when they were out in general cultural situations, they would speak Greek, Koine Greek, not the classical Greek, but Koine, everyday Greek. But not just that, also too, there was Latin, that being the language of the Roman political military influence over the top of all this. So they've got four languages that they're interacting in and thinking in, and they're speaking, they've written it down in Greek to help us understand all that Jesus is, all that God has done through Jesus, and they particularly use two predominant terms for love and two subdominant terms. We looked at the first predominant term, agape, last session, and this session we're going to look at phileo, the second predominant term for love in the Greek language. Let's pray and we're going to get stuck into it. Our Lord and our God, we thank you for this opportunity to open the Word of God and to study what it means for us and our lives and us as a church as we try and love God and love others. Bless us in this time as we look at the Summer of Love series. Would you help us to understand even more of your love for us and how we are to love one another? We pray in your name. Amen. Phileo. Phileo is a really important word, and it comes in a couple of different forms. And so I just want to highlight those forms for us and give us some examples to help us. So let me give you just a brief snapshot. It's a brotherly love. It's a friendship love. It's a companionship. It's a friendship that's as close as siblings. If you had friends that are so close, they're the family you've chosen to have. That's phileo. Let me give you a couple of examples. Phileo means friendship. This is the noun for it. We've got one occurrence in the New Testament, James chapter 4, verse 4. He says, "You adulterous people, do you not know that phileo, that being friendship with the world, is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a phileo, a friend of the world, makes himself an enemy of God." So the Greek language here has got a really clear distinction. Phileo meaning friendship, friendly with, or enemy. There's only two camps in their way of thinking. So that first word, phileo. Then we have phileo. This is the verb. This means to love, to cherish, to have affection for. And that has 25 occurrences in the New Testament. Let me give you a couple of examples. Here's some with this powerfully good sense to the word. John chapter 5, verses 20. "For the Father phileo the Son. He loves the Son and shows him everything that he is doing, and he will show him greater works than these, and you will be amazed." John 16, verses 27. "For the Father himself phileo loves you." He phileo you. "Because you have phileo loved me and have come to believe that I have come forth from God." Revelation chapter 3, verses 19. "To whom I phileo love, I reprove and discipline, so be zealous and repent." So that's in the good sense, but phileo can also be in a bad sense. Have a look, John 3:19, just a little bit further on from John 3:16. He says, "And this is the judgment. The light has come into the world, and people phileo loved the darkness. They made friendship with the darkness rather than the light because their works were evil." John chapter 12, verses 25. "Whoever phileo loves, makes a friendship, his life loses it. Whoever hates his life, makes an enemy of his life in this world, will keep it for eternal life." 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verses 22. "If anyone has no phileo, love, friendship, love for the Lord, let him be accursed. Our Lord come." And Revelation chapter 22, verses 15. "Blessed are those who wash their robes, so that they may have the right to the tree of life, that they may enter the city by the gates." This is talking about the new heavens and the new earth, rejoicing at all, a renewed creation. And he says, these are the people who are enjoying the new heavens and the new earth. And then there's this outer place, this outer darkness, this hell place. "Outside are the dogs and the sorcerers and the sexually immoral and the murderers and the idolaters and everyone who phileo loves, makes friendship with and practices falsehood." So phileo, to love, to make friends with, can be a good thing towards God or a bad thing if it's towards the world. And we get stuck in this idea of you're either friends or enemies. That's the way the Greek language works. That's the way their cultural pictures make sense. So what's the distinction then between agape and phileo? What's the difference? Well, we've actually got a really powerful story at the end of John's gospel where it switches between the two. Have a look, John chapter 21, verses 15 to 17. "And when the resurrected Jesus had finished breakfast, he said to Simon Peter, 'Simon, son of John, do you agape me more than these?' He said to him, 'Yes, Lord, you know that I phileo you.' He said, 'Then feed my lambs.' He said to him a second time, 'Simon, son of John, do you agape me?' He said to them, 'Yes, Lord, you know that I phileo you.' He said to him, 'Then tend my sheep.' He said to him then the third time, 'Simon, son of John, do you phileo me?' And Peter was grieved. He'd said to him this third time, 'Do you phileo me?' He said to him, 'Lord, you know everything. You know that I phileo love you.' And Jesus said to him, 'Feed my sheep.'" What Jesus is doing here is he's restoring Peter after he's denied Jesus three times. He's asking him this question: will you love like I have loved on that cross? Will you love like that? And Peter, I think maybe for some of the first time of what we've read of him in the Gospels, is starting to get it. Instead of having this boldness of going, "I will go with you even unto death," he's honest: "I don't have the capacity to love like you loved, but I am your friend. And I do love you as best as I can." He's responding to God with the best love that he's got, phileo love. And then Jesus on that third time goes, "Well, do you really actually phileo me? Are you friends with me?" And when Peter says yes, it's this restoration of Peter. then instead of denying Jesus that he didn't even know him, no, I am God's friend. I am Jesus' friend because I've received the agape love of God. So there's this distinction here that's kept. As much as they are, there's a lot of overlap between these two words. There is a slight distinction that is kept. The next word then is the proper noun, philos. That means I am in that now title of friend. And there's 29 occurrences of that in the New Testament. It's a repeated word. Let's have a look at it. Matthew chapter 11, verses 19. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, look at him, a glutton and a drunkard, a philos, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet wisdom is justified by her deeds. And in John chapter 15, verses 12 to 15, he says, this is my commandment, that you agape one another as I have agaped you. Greater agape has no one than this, than someone that lays down his life for his philos, his friend. And you are my philos if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for servants do not know what his master is doing. But I have called you philos. For all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. The powerful point of this is that because of the agape love of God, we are now given this new title, philos, friend of God. No longer enemy of God, but now friend of God because of the agape love of God. That's amazing. Final one, Philadelphia. One occurrence in the New Testament. It's a compound word of phila, that love, and then adelphi, brothers. It's a brotherly love. 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 8. Finally, all of you have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. So how do we define this love? How do we define a phileo love? Through God's agape love, he made us no longer friends of the world and enemies of God, but instead enemies of the world and philos, friends with God. Agape plus phileo love has transformed us into philos, friends of God, and to live then as a new family of God. In this way, the New Testament authors are doing some significant deconstruction of their cultures and reconstructing a completely new type of way of living as a family. See, the Hebrew people, they arranged people by tribe. What tribe are you a part of? The Greek people, they arranged people as either Greek or barbarian. In other words, you either spoke Greek or you spoke Babel. That's what that word barbarian means. The way you speak is like Babel to me. They arranged people by effectively education and language. And then the Romans, they delineated between people by family. By family. Where were you born? What's your last name? That's adding it in. But that kind of idea of who's your family group, and they did that for military and taxation purposes. But Jesus' teaching, as recorded faithfully for us by the New Testament authors, is saying, no, we're not divided by tribe, we're not divided by language, we're not divided into family groups like the Romans would want us to be. No, we have a new way to delineate between people. And it's whether you have received the agape, the love of God, the phileo of God, that you are now a philos, a friend of God and friend to one another. That's exactly what we see in Mark chapter 3, verses 31 to 35. Jesus' mother and Jesus' brothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him and called him. And a crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, Jesus, your mother and your brothers are outside seeking you. And Jesus answered them, who are my mother? Who are my brothers? Looking about at those who sat around him, he said, here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of God, he is my brother and sister and mother. So then, obvious question, what then is the will of God? Here is the will of God for your life, to receive the agape love of God, that you may move from being an enemy of God to a philos, a friend of God, that you may show God's agape, his love, to your new family, those who have been made a friend of God. That's God's will for your life. Will you take it? will you receive the love of God and become a friend of God to be in a new family of God. That's amazing news of the love of God. So, how do we apply it? How do we apply Phileo love to our own lives today? First, being loved by God must result in loving your brothers and sisters in Christ. Let me give you a number of verses quickly here. Romans 12:10, love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. 1 Thessalonians 4:9, now concerning brotherly love, you have no need for anyone to write to you, for you yourselves have been taught by God to love one another. Hebrews 13:1, let brotherly love continue. 2 Peter 1:7, godliness with brotherly affection and brotherly affection with love. 1 Peter 1:22, having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth for a sincere brotherly love, love one another earnestly from a pure heart. My friends, there's a potential risk here, and I want to just name it straight away, that we become cliques. If we have this love one for another as a church, what we can do is become our own little cliques. But we want to fight against cliques by seeing that we've been made, philos, friends with God, by the agape of God, a love we did not deserve. So it's not about finding people who are like you, but rather people are all like you because you're all sinners. You all don't deserve God's love. We all don't deserve God's love. We couldn't pay him back, and yet he has loved us. And therefore, we cannot remain as cliques, but we do love the brothers in a way that is welcoming and inviting to all to receive agape love. Second, we fight against cliques by seeing that our church family is our actual family. I hope that part of what you get out of this series is removing the phrase church family from your vocabulary. You don't have a church family. You have your actual family, which is what you used to call your church family, and you've got your biological family. And your biological family now in Christ is lesser than your church family. Your actual family is your brothers and sisters in Christ. And what Jesus is saying, when sometimes fathers and mothers and sisters and brothers and mother-in-laws and daughter-in-laws are going to hate one another, that's because your true allegiance for family has now been given over to your family in Christ, not your biological family. And some of your biological family is going to hate you for that, but you've got to deal with it for the sake of the gospel. That's a big thing, but we've got to do it. We've got to love one another in a powerful way. So how do we do that at Eaton Baptist Church? How do we make sure that if you walk into our doors, you feel loved? We use an acronym, WISH. First time someone comes through the door, welcome them. Hi, how are you doing? Good to see you. We want to be a welcoming church. Second, I, invite. Invite them. Invite them around for a cuppa. Invite them around for something to eat, for dinner. Invite them to your small group. Welcome them the first time you meet them. Second time you meet them, invite them to something. S, share. Share your life with them. Get to know them. Let them get to know you. Fourth, H, help. Ask them to help somewhere in the church. Hey, would you help me with kids' church? Hey, would you help me with welcoming on the door? Hey, would you help me with whatever ministry you're a part of? We want to use this acronym, WISH, as a way of thinking about loving our brothers and sisters in Christ, welcoming them into the church by giving them a welcome first time they come, inviting them to something, sharing life with them, and asking them to help in our church. That's our process. That's how we want to become this family of God. Second, our love for the brothers is actually an evangelistic love. It's to win the lost. We love our brothers and sisters in Christ for a reason to show that we've been loved. John chapter 13, verse 35, a new commandment I give to you, that you agape one another, just as I have agape loved you, you also are to agape one another. By this all people will know that you are my disciples if you have agape for one another. If you can't love your new family because of the love you've received, because of the command of our Savior, Lord, and King Jesus here, then one, there's probably a stubbornness in you that you need to deal with. But second, love your brothers and sisters in Christ so that the lost may see the love of God in action. Oh, that Eaton Baptist Church would be a place where the love of God is just dripping in every word we say, in every interaction we have with one another. And so in this Summer of Love series, I implore you and I charge you upon these texts of Scripture to love one another now that you've been made friends of God by this agape love of God. Be a philo, a loving church. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We'll see you in the next session.